Hey guys, you're tuning back in to the Rappler Gaming League's online invitational, and we actually finished the first game of this best of three match. And it's a match between UP, Oblation eSports, and UST Tiger eSports. So now we're going into game two and see if UST will be able to win this game and make it to game three, basically.
Yeah, and if you guys haven't watched the first game, haven't seen it yet, well, only thing I could tell you guys, it's a really, really big bloodbath.
Yes, guys. Very red wedding from Game of Thrones. So guys, please check out Rappler.com after this match so you can check out the highlights and the recaps. And we're actually going to do a few shout-outs for you guys.
Yeah. And the first shout-out will
So the first shout-out is actually coming in from Aaron. He is the team captain of UST Tiger eSports. And he's saying hello to the juniors of the LM3 block. So, hi guys, coming in from Aaron.
Yeah, and the second shout-out will be coming from Kip34, addressed to Alden Buenaventura. And he just wants to say, I love you, bro.
Brotherly love, I love it.
Yeah. And another shout-out will be coming from Gerard Jesale, and he just wants to say hi to his teammates.
He's from APC.
He's from APC Rams, and they were the team that played last week.
So guys, once again, recaps and highlights, go to Rappler.com. And I'm actually saying hi to Poisanity and Hate, who are players for IPT, yeah. Guys. So hi guys, it was really nice to meet you, and they're going to actually be playing at Rampage. Yeah. Rampage is the League of Legends convention, guys, that's being organized by Garena. And it's going to be held in the World Trade Center this year on August 22. So guys, please, if you haven't bought your tickets yet, buy your tickets. Go to greenlight.com to find out how you can get your tickets and be part of an amazing event. And if I'm not mistaken, we're gonna be there, guys, at Rampage and cover the event for you guys. So please do go and support the League of Legends community and check out everything that's in store in that convention. And speaking of which, we actually have a trailer for you guys to give you an idea of what's gonna be in Rampage.
Yeah. And Garena.
So now, guys, we're gonna get into game two of this best of three match between UP Oblation Esports and UST Tiger Esports. So we're gonna go to the pick and ban phase and see what they're going to do in reaction to what happened in that first game, guys. So let's check it out.
Yeah, and right now I think UST must be thinking they should really ban the Riven.
Because they're, the top lane of UP was not afraid to blind pick the Riven. So we're gonna see if that's and they actually banned the Thresh. Interesting. UP Oblation Esports banning the Thresh even though they used the Thresh last game. Yeah. The Fizz was once again banned.
Yeah, and this Fizz ban is looking to be a very targeted ban against the mid laner of UP. They might have looked at his account and see that it's the most played champion.
A little bit of espionage, I think.
Yeah, actually, it's, yeah, research. And there it is.
There it is, guys. The ban. The Riven ban coming in from UST Tiger Esports. And now we're going to see the last bans coming in from both teams. The Aurelia being the last ban for UP Oblation Esports. And now we're going to wait for the third ban.
Yeah, and the Lulu ban has been a ban since the first game coming from UP, and I'm not really sure if this ban against their mid laner or their support. And actually UST opting for a last Annie ban. I think they banned this one last game.
That was actually their first ban, if I am not mistaken. And to be honest, I'm pretty sure it's probably a targeted ban either at their support or mid laner probably, but I'm honestly not surprised, because at least for me personally, I almost always tried to ban Annie in ranked games just because she's very versatile, especially with her passive of being able to have that stun after using four spells.
Yeah, that's true. And Annie, I guess, is a really good ban since, yeah, as you mentioned, that she has this the Tibbers,
which Tibbers. Really changes,
that really changes the face of the fight. And right now, UP hovering on a Nidalee.
Previously a Ryze, and we're gonna see if they're going to lock that in for their jungle. A few seconds left. I have to admit, I really do love Nidalee jungle. I feel like the best Nidalee jungle I know is actually Move from Gravity, from NALCS, because Move is one of the only professional junglers, at least in the NALCS, that actually buys a sight stone.
Yeah.
They actually prioritize vision, and he's really aggressive with how he intervenes in lane.
Yeah,
so we're gonna see. But it's actually not a Nidalee, but an Elise. Yeah. Oh my god. Wow. An amazing jungler in this patch, in this meta right now, guys.
The Elise right now going through the ban phase and I think it's a very good first pick for UP right now.
It is a very good first pick.
And UST going back to that Corki, and now they're getting the Rek'Sai.
The Rek'Sai now this time. And now we're gonna see the next two picks coming in from UP Oblation eSports. Now, I know you and I love talking about how Elise is one of the strongest junglers in the meta right now. And if I'm not mistaken, at least last season, she was almost even never picked because of how weak she was. But right now, especially with how her spider minions, I don't think that's the right term, but how her spiders, for example, they actually have magic damage, so they don't scale off late game compared to how they did before. There's just a lot of buffs working in her favor and making her so strong at this meta right now.
Yeah, and all the other patches before, those small slight buffs to her, especially from her for her damage under her Q, and the cocoon duration has made her go back to her season 3 form, where she was a really strong jungler during that time. She has amazing clear speed in the jungle. She gets she's very healthy even after clearing
the first
time in the jungle, and she can even make effective ganks because of her cocoon.
Really good early lane ganking for that. And now we see that the three champions that were locked in by UP Oblation Esports are the Elise, the Alistar, and the Sivir. And now we're gonna see the next pick coming in for UST Tiger Esports with the Corki and the Rek'Sai already locked in. They're hovering over the Nautilus right now. And now, the Alistar pick, for example, coming in from UP Oblation Esports. Really good in team fight. A lot of peel that's going to come in. And with the Sivir especially, and with that mobility, being able to couple with that, it's just going to be amazing coming in for them, especially mid to late game.
Yeah, and right now, I think UP is opting for more of an engage comp, since I think a Sivir early pick doesn't really say much. It could be about a counter engage comp or a kite comp because of her ult. But right now, by picking an Alistar, they can have a counter engage and engage comp,
because they have options basically.
Yeah,
now.
And Sivir popping her ult and using this Alistar to initiate fights would be a very good tool.
And in the event where they didn't want to fight, for example, he also has the headbutt and the pulverize to give his teammates enough time to back away if needed. And now we see that the two picks that were locked in by UST Tiger Esports is actually the Nautilus and the Malphite. And now we see the last two picks are going to come in for UP Oblation Esports. How do you feel about the lineup right now for UST Tiger Esports, 4 out of 5 champions already being picked?
I think they should pick a very high damage output mid laner right now.
Exactly!
They're lacking a lot of damage, and I think they have a lot of magic damage, though Rek'Sai could deal a lot of AD.
If he was built, if she was built. Guys, Rek'Sai is a girl. I apologize for saying he. If she was built a little bit more of a fighter than a tank, because at least as of now, she's usually built as a tank right now.
Yeah, with the Cinder Hulk. Yeah, she's very effective with the Cinder Hulk. Though I think if a Rek'Sai gets a lot of kills in the early game, if she opts to get a warrior enchantment, it could also prove to be a very good snowball tool for her. And right now, UP Oblation Esports last picking both the Victor and the Rumble, showing that they really want to have a lot of damage.
There
in these
is
fights.
A lot of damage coming in from, and I feel like it was a really great last two picks coming in for UP Oblation Esports, because like how I talked about with Taknum in our previous castings, for example, Sivir is obviously picked for her utility with her ultimate, right? But at the same time, she is not the highest damage output ADR. But the thing is, what UP Oblation eSports did is compensate for that lack of damage coming in from Sivir's kit and making it up with the Rumble and the Victor. It's gonna be exciting, guys.
Yeah, and these two champions now give a lot of zone control in these fights.
Yes.
Rumble's ult.
Equalizer. People will part like the Red Sea when that's landed.
Yeah, and for example, in a fight, if the Victor lands a very good gravity field, couple with that equalizer and a laser coming from the Victor, it'll just burn through the UST lineup right now.
This is interesting, actually, because you talked about how the final pick of UST Tiger Esports is actually supposed to be more damage output oriented, considering the lineup so far with the Nautilus, with the Malphite, and possibly the Rexy, depending on how she's built. But the Varus pick, for example, is really interesting, considering how quirky is magic penetration. And now they have the Varus, who I believe is going to use armor penetration runes more often than not.
I'm not really sure if that Varus is a really good pick, since there's a Sivir that runs towards you. But a Malphite can also be pretty effective, since a Malphite could build AP.
That's the thing, because I equate Varus and Kog'Maw not necessarily in terms of damage output of their kit, but more of how they can be extremely effective if you have an amazing frontline. And I feel like if UST Tiger Esports will be able to give a good frontline to their damage champions, basically their carries, then they might be able to outpoke, basically.
Yeah. And right now
they're a poke comp, definitely, with the Corki and the Varus pick.
Yeah. And right now we're gonna show player profiles from the UST with Darren Sia as Icon at the top lane, Joel Cayago as Hearts Art in the mid lane, James Ortiz as James Meister in the jungle, Aaron Ke AD Carry as Raze, and Ramesses Pedroso as support on Schnitzel.
And now we're going to see the player profiles from the other team, which is going to be UP Oblation Esports. So once again, we have Clyde for the top lane, we have Siegfried for the mid lane, Vincent Rivera for their jungle, Francis as the attack damage carry, and we have Aldrin as their support. So I'm really excited for this matchup, and I feel like a lot of the viewers are excited, because I know during the break we were looking at the Twitch chat, and basically everyone went wild for that Riven. Yeah. Obviously, they're not going to be able to see that again, but we're going to see if Toki has anything else up his sleeves playing this Rumble.
Yeah, and I think Rumble right now in this patch is in a very good place, especially the recent buffs to the buffs for him on the AP items. It may not be buffs for other champions, because Rumble right now, getting a Leandis first could really output so much damage. And getting a Rylai's also would really give Rumble a good platform to carry this game, just like how Toki did earlier with that Riven.
Because you mentioned about these items, and I completely agree. And especially since these items have a health component, for example, he won't necessarily be as squishy compared to if he got other items, for example. So it'll definitely be to his advantage, having this enormous amount of AP damage while still having more survivability, basically, during team clashes and even in lane. So we're going to see how that is going to turn out. And I feel like, at least in the early game, people are going to be relying on their junglers for a lot of pressure.
Yeah, I think this game also will rely a lot on the top lane matchup. Because as we saw
Malphite
earlier...
Malphite versus the Rumble.
Yeah, it's a Malphite versus Rumble. And as we saw earlier, Toki had a big advantage in the top lane.
Exactly.
And I don't think right now that a Malphite can do better.
No, actually, the Malphite was definitely counterpicked. I think you and I can both agree with that, because, I mean, I'm going to be revealing something about myself right now. Malphite is probably one of the only champions I can decently play in top lane. But I never blind pick Malphite at top lane. I never ever do. I only volunteer myself as tribute. Katniss Everdeen style, basically. When the enemy team picks a champion where the Malphite serves as the counter, like a Jax or an Aurelia, then I'm like, okay guys, put me at top lane. I'm gonna play a Malphite. But other than that, he can be extremely bullied, and I feel like that might be the case against the Rumble.
Yeah, and actually very worried for this UST comp right now. Mm-hmm. I don't see them having a lot of damage. Especially when compared to this UP lineup.
The UP Rumble, lineup is insane. The
and the Sivir for that small additional AD.
Mm-hmm.
But on the other hand, UST does have these three possible big tanks in the front line, which could give Varus a lot of time to poke out, and also with Corki with his rockets. But with the UST line, with the UP lineup, if they could engage well enough with the Sivir ult, this UST lineup might just get wrecked.
Actually, how I'm envisioning these team fights, how they're going to happen is, I feel like in a 5v5 clash, wherein everyone just goes in samurai style, basically, I feel like UST is going to have the disadvantage. But I feel like if they actually delay fights and poke, and basically outpoke UP from a distance and delay head-on clashes, they might be able to have that advantage. So it's honestly all about the timing. And now we see that the members from both teams are actually grouping up, and there's pings coming in from the teams.
Yeah, and UST right now trying to go for a more defensive style of early game, but UP trying to get that deep wards as they did in the first game. Right now, the teams opt to be more passive. I don't think there will be any fights in the jungle.
Yeah, I don't think there's going to be any jungling in base right now. And a ward planted in by the Varus just to make sure that the red side of the jungle of UST will not be stolen, yeah, basically.
I actually think this is a very good adaptation from UST, because UST earlier saw that UP was going for the bot side jungle. And right now, UST also mirrored that, expecting that UP would do the same thing, so that the wards right now for UP are not as deep as before, only in the river.
Just to get an idea of at least of where the enemy team is going to go, and being able to respond to that properly is important. Even if you're not necessarily going to proceed with invading the jungle, information, as you said, for the first game is very important.
Yeah, and right now the teams are opting for standard lanes, though I think Talky Talky will do his early level 2 shenanigans again.
His shenanigans right now. I think so. He'll probably clear the camp, go back once again, and have that advantage over Malphite.
Yeah, and I think also Victor helped Rumble over there using one laser on the Raptor camp, mm-hmm, so that it would be easier for Rumble to clear that camp.
And not too much time, because that's always a disadvantage with clearing camps on your own as a top laner. More often than not, if you don't get that little bit of assistance, it might actually work against you in terms of CS, but you can easily catch that up if you're really good at CS mechanics.
Yeah, and
oh, but there is, once again, there's a lot of trading coming in from the bot lanes of UST and UP, and now a lot of damage was taken in by the Sivir and the Alistar of UP, and we're gonna see if they're going to land again. Oh, and a Phosphorus Bond forcing him to actually use a Pulverize, and he is at less than half health right now.
Yeah, and I think their UP opted to get a camp. That's why the Sivir got an earlier level 2 than her support, and it didn't really do much good for them since they're actually being pressured a lot in the lane. Though we might see in the later part of this laning phase that they may get an advantage because of that experience.
So Malphite is trying to actually see as safely as much as possible, but he's just taking too much damage from the Rumble. Yeah. Oh my god, he's going to get bullied. I feel it, guys. Yeah, I feel like his strategy will probably just to see as safely as possible, right?
Yeah, and the Rumble opting for Ruby Crystal first, which would make him very tanky in this top lane.
The Phosphorus Bomb landing once again from the Corki. A lot of trading happening in both sides, and the Rek'Sai is actually making his way top lane, and will they be able to take down the Rumble? There's actually going to be... Oh, and he was actually forced to blow his flash. But a flash well worth using, because he is safe. And now bottom lane is actually having a lot of trading going on. Will they be able to kill the Nautilus for overextending? He does blow a flash, and he actually tried to use a dredge line. Thank God it didn't land, because he would have been pulled again to his enemies.
Yeah, this is like a reflection of what happened earlier in the earlier game in the bot lane, where UP now get the blue side getting the advantage in that bot lane. I'm sorry, actually earlier UST was the one that's getting the early advantage of that bot lane.
Wow, and now the tides have turned because initially, at least the beginning, it was the bot lane of
UST
that was having an easier time, and now they're having a hard time at this point. And now mid lane is relatively even, at least in terms of CS, and not too much trading happening with them. I think they're really maximizing their ranges at this point, both the Victor and the Varus, and they're trying to CS properly, maybe waiting for jungler interference, as what I'd like to call it. And now Elise is actually by the bush, and will she be able to? No, but there was a very nicely placed ward just in time for him to see that Elise was nearby, forcing him to back away.
Yeah, and to point out earlier why I was worried for this UST lineup, since they have only two damage dealers and they are poke champions, to be more exact,
mm-hmm.
poke comps need to have this early advantage in the laning phase so that they could deal more damage
later on.
But right now, they're kind of losing this laning phase with UP having a 400 gold advantage in 5 minutes.
And now, as I expected, the Malphite is just being bullied and he can't even CS safely in his own lane with the Rumble and at least 11 CS up on the Malphite. Not surprising, obviously. Hey, like I said before, I know the difficulties of playing Malphite top. You only play him when he's a really good counterpick. And now he was severely counterpicked, even being forced to go back without a lot of money in his pocket.
Yeah, and this mid lane also, Victor having a slight CS advantage at 5. But I get this mid lane also, Victor would have a good advantage if a gank coming from the Rek'Sai would be successful. And right now, the blue team opting to get the dragon.
Wow, and of course, since there's no ward, I don't think the team actually knows it's going. Oh no, but a ward was placed and they are forced to retreat. The Varus does use his ultimate and they might be able to take first win against the Elise. But no, she was able to escape and they might actually get the Sivir. The Dredgeline misses the Alistar and she's trying to get away with her spell shield as much as possible. Forced to blow her flash. That was amazing. And now they're trying to retreat to the safety of their turrets and the Varus trying to charge his arrow. And it does hit, but nobody has died. That was insane! I thought there were so many times that a first blood was going to be drawn on both sides of the team.
Yeah, and actually, this is a very risky dragon take from the UP lineup right there. But they got away safely, only having three members on the red.
No, but USC was really smart though, because they noticed that the laners were missing.
Yeah.
And the first thought that came to their mind is, they're doing dragon. And they responded immediately, which was really good. And a lot of the members were severely low health, and I actually saw what the Sivir did, because the Alistar was at severely low health, that if the dredge line from the Nautilus actually hit, he would have died for sure.
Yeah.
But the Sivir actually took the hit and basically trusted that her spell shield combination with her flash would be able to get her out safely, and it did work. So that was really, really good.
Yeah,
the love for your bot lane, guys.
Protect your support, guys. It will give you a lot of benefits. And actually, there's a pause in game. And that fight...
Now we have time to talk about this because so much action has been happening thus far.
And I think UST right now is playing this game a lot smarter than earlier.
I think so. They probably learned from their mistakes from the first game.
Yeah, and earlier, there's just so much aggression on these two teams. UP still showing that they have a lot of aggression in their minds, but USC trying to play this laning phase very smartly, and maybe they might get to that point in the mid game where they can poke out the UP lineup.
And actually, a lot of trading going once again at top lane, and the Malphite is actually doing a lot of damage, and the equalizer does land. He was forced to blow his flash, and with his potions chugged at the right time, he was able to protect himself, and now he's trying not to leave his turret. There are definitely separation issues going on at top lane, and now bot lane, once again, there's going to be... Oh, and the Rumble might actually tower die. Will he do it? But the Malphite does use his ultimate, and we see that the Rumble is being smart, not landing any hits on the Malphite for turret aggression.
Yeah, I think Rumble right there trying to be very greedy, but right now the Rek'Sai.
Oh, and the Rek'Sai might unburrow on time, and he even using his smite, and the first blood does go to the Rek'Sai. So the first blood goes in favor of UST.
Yeah, and that was played very smartly by the Malphite right
he
there.
He baited him out!
Yeah, and as I said earlier, UP is still showing signs of their over-aggression from the earlier game. And UP right now trying to take the Dragon since they saw the Rek'Sai at top.
Mm-hmm. They're trying basically to address that and try to make it a relatively equal trade. You get First Blood, we get Dragon. And yeah. I think they will get this without any contention.
Yeah, and actually a very smart trade for UP right there because they saw the Rek'Sai at top and knowing that he's she's only level 5.
Good job. Pronouns are important, guys.
She doesn't have her ultimate yet.
Mm-hmm.
I just think UP right now needs to calm down a bit. They have a lead series advantage. They just need to play this game very smart.
Oh, and it's gonna be further trading at bot lane. And the dredge line does land. And the phosphorus bomb. Will they be able to pursue this? I don't think so. And we see that Elise is making her way towards bot lane. And they might actually make this a 3v2 fight. And I don't think it's warded. Yup, she used her sweeper for this. So we're gonna see what's going to happen. The dredge line does land and the phosphorus bomb.
Oh,
the Corki does Valkyrie in. But not enough time. And will they be able to take at least one member down? Yes! Oh my god, now it is a 1-for-2 trade in favor of UST.
Yeah, and right there, UST, I really thought they had the advantage, but the Elise showing up, knowing the timing of, I think the team was calling for their jungler to go down at bot. And here's a replay showing the fight. Here, right here, there's a very good Alistar Pulverize right there, knocking up two members from UST, which ultimately won them the fight and gave them a 2-for-1 advantage.
That was really, really good. And the thing is, that was that blind spot that the Elise was banking on because she used her sweeper ward. Okay, they don't know in the tri-bush. And she stayed really close to the point where as soon as that pulverize was landed, they were all able to respond to that brightly placed move. And now the Rek'Sai is making her way once again at top lane. Even though the equalizer does land, both the Malphite does use his ultimate to knock him up in the air. Will they be able to catch him? The Prey Seeker Queen's Wrath actually does work and he's trying to slow them as much as possible. The mid laners try to respond, but the Varus might actually be punished for it. And the Elise trying to get the Rek'Sai for going a little bit too close to their pet Yordle. Oh, and he actually is able to kill the Rek'Sai mid-tunneling. And now that was a 2-4-0 trade in favor of UP.
Yeah, UP right there showing what they also do in the early game, in the earlier game, where they would do these rotations very well and they would react to these ganks, counter ganks very fast. Actually, James Meister right there just mispositioning himself.
Exactly.
Especially when you're in the mid lane, when you're the one trying to react to a fight earlier, you should always be mindful of your flanks. And I think James Meister right there just tunneled too much in the top lane.
I agree with that. Oh, and there is the dredge line almost landed. That definitely would have been another skirmish at bot lane. And they were able to take, or UP rather, was able to take the first tier top turret of UST. And now we're gonna see, as of now, the junglers are clearing camps and the Malphite is trying to catch up on his CS because he is really well behind against the Rumble. And now there is a teleport coming in from UP and will they be able to catch the members off guard? Oh, and he actually does use the ultimate, the Nautilus rather, and they're trying to punish Alistar. They're able to kill the Sivir of UP and they want to get another member. They're trying to slow him and the dredge line does land and the Corki from UST was able to snipe him out of the woods and now Toki Toki is just alone there with his minions.
Yeah, right there, Rumble trying to influence the fight by teleporting, but he didn't have his ult yet. So he couldn't do the same impact that he could as a Rumble.
Now he does.
Yeah, now he does. But we could see here the strength of the bot lane for UST. It's the only shining point for them in this game with their
mid lane and top lane being relatively behind.
Yeah, especially in the CS. With mm-hmm. Rumble almost having a 40 CS advantage on that Malphite, and the Victor having a 30 CS advantage against that Varus.
At least the 30 CS advantage. Yeah. Oh, and now Toki Toki was actually caught off guard by the Rek'Sai, but he does have his equalizer and the Rek'Sai is trying to escape as much as possible, but no, too much damage was put out and he is dead.
Yeah, and UP right now enjoying a 1k gold lead against the UST.
Let's see, and now Dragon is gonna be up in less than 2 minutes. UP was able to get the Scuttle, an endangered species, in my opinion. And now we're gonna see how these teams are going to respond to them. Will UST actually contest the possible second Dragon of UP and take their first? We'll just see.
Yeah, we'll see. Actually, wanted to add that to that scuttle point right there.
What about the scuttle?
The scuttle are really this newest part of the jungle for Riot right now.
Yeah.
It's a very endangered species, but I still wonder, where did they all come from? Every time they get good, they just come back to life and run away from anyone that's trying to hurt them.
Sounds like cockroaches to me.
So now so they should be named scuttle cockroaches?
Maybe. Oh, and now there is a combination. Oh, from both the Rek'Sai and the Malphite, but they were actually able to secure the kill with a snipe coming in from the Varus, even though he missed his ultimate.
Yeah, that is a
can't give him crap anymore.
Well, that is a pretty nice gank coming from UST, and it shows how actually the victor right there was just severely out position, but I think the team should have called that top lane.
See, it was perfect because we see that the Malphite landed his ultimate, and then the Rek'Sai also wanted to make sure that they were able to secure the kill, and they were able to do so with the Varus being able to snipe at a relatively long distance.
Yeah, and the Lee's actually right there flashing, trying to cocoon someone.
So that was a blown summoner spell also. So that will definitely be in favor of UST. And now Jagged is going to be up in less than 5 seconds. And we're going to see if the teams are going to start making their way towards there. Malphite has no teleport and neither does the Rumble.
But the Rumble right now can go to the bot lane faster, since I think the Rumble shoved the top lane so that they could prep for this dragon.
I think between all the lanes, in terms of pushing your wave control, probably the most pressure will fall on the top lane, for sure. And now we see that UP actually made their way first, like you expected. They're trying to clear as much wards as they can. And I remember you mentioning the initial qualms you had about the team composition of UST not having enough damage output. And we can see the Rek'Sai actually not getting the Cinderhulk, for example. Yeah. We see they got the Warrior.
Yeah, but right now I think UST will have another problem, since their Rek'Sai got the Warrior enchantment, which tells UP right now that there will be most of the damage coming from UST right now will be AD.
Exactly.
Though, yeah, we can say that Corki has a lot of magic damage using his rockets, but his basic attacks are practically AD also.
Exactly. And now they're trying. Oh, and the Corki Valkyrie's in, trying to take in the Sivir, trying to take out all the special. He is taking turret aggro. He lands his Crossroads Bond. The Sivir uses her heal. And now I don't think any chain is going to happen. The Elise tries to make her way to bot lane, and the Nautilus is there too. And also in mid lane, a few training coming in from both sides.
Yeah, Corki right there showing his power spike right now, though he doesn't have his Triforce yet. His Sheen and Page is enough to try to beat out the Sivir with only an Avarice Blade and a pickaxe.
He did surprisingly well, honestly. He even took a few shots from the tower.
Yeah,
Corki knows his power.
Yeah, and you can really see that Sivir is usually picked in compositions where she's not really the primary damage dealer.
Exactly.
They only need her speed up.
And now the Elise was trying to go and contest the dragon with the Allosaur being by her side, but she might actually be punished for it. The Equalizer does land, but I don't think anyone's gonna die from it. The Corki was able to use his heal just in time. And now UST killed two members of UP and they want more blood. Will they be able to land a dredge line coming in? And I'm not sure. Oh, and the Corki was able to take down the Alistar from UP, and now it's a 3-4-1 trade in favor of UST, but it might actually be in further favor. They're trying to get the victor who is left alone, and the support actually does land. And will it be an ace? They're trying to get the Sivir as much as possible. Will they be able to do it? They're trying to tower dive. No, the spell shield was able to take away any of the effects of the Malphite's Q. And wow, that was an incredible fight in favor of UST, who are going to most probably be able to secure their first dragon of the game. And here's replay for you guys.
Replay right here. The Alistar actually getting stunned. He couldn't use his Pulverize right there. And picking off the Elise by UST was what won them the fight right here. The Equalizer from Rumble wasn't really in the best position possible for that fight. And after killing this Alistar off screen right now, Varus was killed by the Victor. But coming back into this fight, Victor is trying to put more aggression, but UST going back to that Victor, and the Sivir trying to poke in was got hooked by the Nautilus.
The dredge line.
Yeah, but Unfortunately, UST didn't get that kill, but it was a very nice team fight for UST since I think UST won that fight since they were all clumped up in that space and they could have defended their two damage.
I actually feel like the timing was just incredibly bad because it was very clear that the Elise and the Alistar were trying to contest the Dragon. But unfortunately, there was not enough of their teammates were nearby, and the Sivir might actually die alone. Oh, and she does die. The spell shield does not save her. No witchcraft for the Corki at all. And oh, the Rumble was actually there trying to take away as much as he can. But will the Corki be able to make this a double kill? No, the Gatling gun does not take away enough damage, and it is a shutdown. And we see the Nautilus almost trying to take on a 1v2, but clearly backing away with the Rek'Sai by him.
Yeah, and so,
oh, wow, as that you was said insane. Earlier,
in the first game, minions are your friends.
Minions are your friends, guys. Rump,
the blue side minions, right? They're block Corki from trying to kite out this Rumble even mm-hmm. more, giving Rumble that kill. But here we could see the power spike of Corki having that Sork Shoes and Triforce.
And the Triforce
only against components of a Infinity Edge for that Sivir.
That's the thing. I know. I always mention how Sivir isn't really known or really picked for her damage output, and the fact that they keep leaving the Sivir alone at bot lane against the Corki has not been working out for them. I think this is at least the second time that the Corki was able to take on the Sivir a 1v1 fight. Only then, with the teleport from the Rumble, was it able to be a relatively equal trade. But even then, they can't leave the Sivir alone anymore. She is meant to be in a group. No man is an island.
Yeah, I actually think right here, UP should try and group up and do the rotations that they did in the first game. They're not trying to do those rotations right now. They're not accomplishing the deep wards that they put in the earlier game. And they only have one turret advantage against UST.
And now Baron is live right now. We see both the top laners are trying to go. Oh, and the Equalizer was landed by the Rumble, taking in a lot of damage. Will he be able to kill the Malphite, who was forced to use his flash?
Yeah, Toki Toki right there showing the strength of Rumble with just Eliandis and Short Shrews, and also having a 40 CS advantage against this Malphite. Though we could see also from the stat line of Malphite, he's 204, so he has this very UST having this very good advantage in terms of team fighting.
And now UST is making their rotations towards mid lane, probably having their eyes set on the first tier mid turret of UP. But no, they back away, and now we're gonna see what they're gonna do. Probably catch the Victor off guard, the Prey Seeker giving the Rek'Sai a good idea of how many enemy members are actually nearby. So that is definitely to their advantage.
UST right now showing the proper respect that they need to show from the UP comp right now, because they have tons of damage. Even though their Sivir is far behind, that Rumble and that Victor can just throw so much magic damage, and I don't see any magic resist items yet, except for the Banshee's Veil.
Exactly.
On that Malphite.
Not a lot of magic resist coming in. The Malphite obviously built that as a counter build, or rather strategically buying items against his matchup, basically. So smart itemization from him, but now he's trying to focus on one of Malphite's core items, arguably the Sunfire's Cape.
Yeah, I actually find it curious that both these junglers opted for a Sightstone. There's a fight happening in bottom.
Once again, the Sivir will probably die alone against the Corki, but she is forced to use her ultimate and her heal and her flash, if I'm not mistaken. She used basically everything, all those spells trying to get away.
Yeah,
and I don't know why they're leaving the Sivir alone at this point. She is, like I said earlier, I'm gonna sound repetitive, but she really is meant to fight as a group.
Yeah, and this, I think UP right now is trying to, they're trying to find ways to break into this, to what UST is doing right now. UP is having these very cluttered fights. They're all over the map one by one. And though, yeah, UST is answering this, I just find out that these teams need to be more, have better shots.
And now the junglers are going at it, but no, there is response coming in from other members of UP. Will the Rek'Sai die? I think the passive was able to save her life with a few chug potions. Oh, and it's actually a tower dive, but a really good flash coming in from the Varus, and nobody was killed. And now Dragon is gonna be up in less than a minute, so we're gonna see what's gonna happen. The dredge line does land. Will they actually be able to do any more than they already did? No, they're trying to respect obviously that much output from UP, and now they're just trying to clear the wave as much as they can in hopes of setting up Dragon.
Yeah, I'm waiting for USC right now to group up since they have this double poke comp. They should try to go for the mid lane right.
And now the dredge line does land, forcing the Malphite to use his ultimate, and they were able to kill Victor practically tower range. And now UP is one member down, and they might either push the first tier mid turret of UP or take Dragon when it spawns.
This is a very good pick and a very good flash hook, flash dredge
line. I was so surprised, honestly.
Yeah, that was a very good pick from USC, which would give them the mid lane turret. Right now, I think there might be a fight happening in this mid lane, but yeah, I think UP would just need to harass UST out of this.
And now they actually might be making their way towards Dragon, and they are. And we're gonna see if UP will be able to contest this. If not, it's going to be the second Dragon for UST.
Yeah, and UP not opting to challenge this Dragon right now. UST having their mid-game power spike with their two poke champions.
Yep.
Especially the Corki, as I mentioned before, has his Triforce.
And now BF Sword. Yeah, Can you imagine that?
And Varus right now having a Last Whisper along with his cooldown boots, which would give him a lot of arrows to shoot at NCT9.
Actually, one thing to think about, I know we talked about how Varus and Corki are poke champs. If you consider Rek'Sai's Prey Seeker as a poke, then you probably have three poke champions.
Yeah.
But they've been playing this really well with their rotation, something we didn't see in the game previous to this. Victor was able to delete the Varus, like it was not a big deal. And even the Corki was forced to use his Valkyrie away. That was a lot of damage. Even I didn't expect it, and I don't think the Varus of UST did either.
Yeah, and the Victor Ace Crosscut right there caught James Meister sleeping, and there's another battle happening in mid lane.
Oh, and the Corki was forced to use his self-heal, and the Sivir was able to take revenge basically for what happened. And now the Equalizer was landed, and they're trying to actually tower dive. The Pulverize was landed by the Alistar, and it's a double kill coming in from the Malphite. And the Dredge Knight once again lands, but no, the Nautilus does die, and they might actually be able to kill the Malphite. He does flash in to get a triple kill, but no, he dies instead. So that was technically the Varus respond now, but
yeah,
it was technically a 5-4-3 trade in favor of UP.
Yeah, it was a delayed ace.
It was a delayed ace, guys. That was insane, and we're gonna see a recap. We need to. Too many things happened.
Yeah, and UP right here tower diving UST with their advantage. UST, I think this shows how less damage they have, especially their Corki and their Varus was the first one to fall in this fight, while all the damage dealers from UP are still alive. Though I think UP stayed too long in this tower dive, they could have focused the tower immediately, but they still won the fight 3-4-5.
That was insane, and now it almost any disadvantage that UP experienced earlier, I think, was almost made up for that fight, because the gold difference now isn't as high as it was earlier. It's at less than 1,000 right now.
Yeah, and UP just showing that their damage output is really off the roof. I think that was a very good engage coming from UP. UST not having enough tools to disengage that fight, because they also have an engage comp. Though they have two poke champions, Nautilus, Malphite, and Rek'Sai are two champions that always goes into the fight.
That's the thing. And it was a really good decision coming in as a team, because like we remember earlier, the Victor deleted that Varus. They knew that it was already a 5-4 fight. And now, the thing is, UST now took the first tier top turret of UP, and they might be able to take the Elise. The Equalizer was blown. Oh, and the Pulverize from the Alistar basically secures the kill, and the Corki does die. And oh, and now two members of UP die, and there's further trading. The Victor coming in trying to take as much damage towards the enemy team as he can. He might actually be able to take a double kill, even though the Varus does land his ultimate to no avail. It is a 2-4-3 trade in favor of UP.
Yeah, and Victor's Ignite right there showing to have good use against that Malphite getting the kill. And I think UST right there just overstayed their welcome.
Yeah, so look, they already got the turret, but they were already extending a little bit way too much out. The Corki even Valkyried in, but it was unfortunate because he basically Valkyried in towards the middle of that Equalizer.
Yeah, and in this fight, we could really see that without the Varus, UST has almost no damage output. Yes, they got the early advantage with some trading at that bottom tower, at that top tower, but without Varus and Corki in that lineup, they just deal no damage to this Elise, Alistar, and Rumble.
And now, actually, the goal difference, obviously, UST has a little bit of an advantage, but Yuki is clawing their way back into the game. And now, Dragon is going to be up in less than 2 minutes. And quite possibly, there might be contention for this one.
Actually, this is a when compared to the first game, this is a very close game between these two
exactly.
teams.
Exactly!
Right,
it's really close right
though
now.
Though it's still a bloodbath everywhere. 31 deaths in 28 minutes. But only 1k gold separate these two teams. And the only advantage that I could see right now from UST is their Dragon advantage at 2. But right now, with the poke comp, I keep on barking in this 2 damage poke comp coming from UST.
Yes.
But they're gonna have a hard time because the mid game is ending. And they may not have enough damage to kill this UP lineup.
And now we see that most of the members of UST are near Dragon at this point, trying to put in as much wards as they can, trying to take away as much wards and deny vision basically for UP. Dragon is going to be up in less than a minute. Malphite return back to base, probably going to save his teleport and walk the whole distance.
Yeah, and right now, Malphite is showing that, Zyken is showing that he's not a pushover against Tokitoki when compared, because he's having a good game right now at 7-2-5. He's
a really good KDA coming in from him, despite the fact that even until now, he is behind in CS against his lane counterpart.
Yeah, and he's really showing us how this Malphite is supposed to be used even in a losing match at the top lane.
That's usually what happens to me.
Yeah, you lose lane, but you win the team fights.
Hey, I wouldn't mind that because I'm a team player. Are you, Crazy Apple?
Yeah, of course I'm a team player.
And now we see that the teleport from the Rumble is going to be up, I think, in less than a minute. Oh, there. Now, both the teleports are up for the top laner. So we're going to see if their fellow members from their respective teams are going to make their way to the Dragon Pit. Is the scuttle out? Have they gone extinct, guys? I don't see it.
The scuttle doesn't want to show itself now in river, knowing that the two teams are hungry for this dragon.
Exactly. The dragon is live right now. And as of now, oh! The cocoon does land, but then the headbutt pulls the Rek'Sai away and he wasn't able to finish clearing that ward.
Yeah, and this top lane would be, whoever gets the better teleport for this fight would decide who wins this. I think right now, UST is making the better decision at not committing to this dragon, just trying to poke out the UP lineup. UP right now, they should try to control the side waves, pull UST out of that dragon pit.
Oh, and they might actually get Tokitoki, who is left alone. The ultimate of the Nautilus was not yet. Oh, and even though the equalizer does land, he was completely obliterated from that. My mistake. The ultimate of the Nautilus wasn't landed. But in response to that,
Malphite is teleporting at Dragon Pit right now. And wow, that nice ultimate from the Malphite. And
it's a double kill coming in from the sliver of UP. And we're going to see if more blood is going to be shed. So many members of UP are actually low right now. The Varus from UST was able to snipe that Elise, and they're trying to get the Victor as well, and they might be able to. Yes, the Corki does that, and they might want to get, and he does flash for the Alistar. It's a double kill coming in from the Corki. Will he be able to take the Sivir? She actually does show herself. Oh, and she actually was able to take down the Corki, but will the Varus be able to take down the Sivir and get revenge for his fallen teammate? And he does. So it is an ace in favor of UST.
And they're, I don't know why UP tried to commit to that dragon. Yeah, I think there's going to be an instant replay right now. And here, Rumble is down. UP took this fight, committed to the dragon with their top laner out of the fight. UST having both of their damage dealers dealing damage from the back and just poking, sniping.
Yeah, the Varus was just safe there. Just throwing arrows, basically.
Yeah, and their front line just stopping any damage coming for their carries. And after UST actually winning that fight, though Sivir got the Corki, I think it was overall win for the UST.
That was really good coming in from UST. And not to mention that Dragon took a significant chunk of health from the members of UP. They were not all completely full health. So by the time UST decided to say, hey, we want to contest your Dragon, it was a 5v4 fight. Because the Malphite also had his teleport. And I'm honestly just as surprised as you are. They were fully aware that the Rumble died.
I think they thought they could sneak that dragon, but the thing that they forgot is that both top laners' teleports were gone. And that the Rumble couldn't obviously react to that fight because he was dead.
But this might be insanity because Yuffie is trying to do the same thing they did earlier, but no, they've proven Albert Einstein wrong. They were actually able to take the dragon. Interesting.
Yeah, it's very surprising.
A lot of trouble for that dragon earlier, and yet they were able to take it.
Yeah, UST not opting to get that dragon. I think I saw them earlier trying to get that dragon with the Rek'Sai over there. But when UP showed up, UST gave that respect towards the UP lineup.
And now the Rumble probably thinks there is sneaky business making his way back to the lane, and there is a pause being held. This game is honestly way more exciting, in my opinion, than the game previously, because compared to the first game, this game, it's way more even. And I honestly don't know who has the edge in terms of winning right now. It's fairly even between the two compared to last game, where a lot of people, especially the members of UST, Tiger eSports, knew that UP had a severe advantage, and they basically capitalized every single step of the way.
Yeah, that's true. And in the earlier game, UP had a very good advantage in the early game. Now they're not finding that advantage because UST right now is playing a lot more smart in this game. UST calculating if they could win these fights. They have this better tank line in front, where they just leave their two damage dealers at the side. And the difference between a Varus and a Victor in terms of poke, Victor's laser is just a short skill shot, and it can't hit the back line, unlike Corki's rocket and Varus's.
Both of their skill shots
can hit the back line.
That's the thing. So their positioning is really important for this, because they're basically playing like two AD carries. And as of now, with the exception of a few skirmishes, they've been playing a lot smarter, making their frontline distract all the members of UP such that they can be safe at the sidelines and dealing as much damage as they can while being safe. Because that's really important for a team comp. And they've been playing these fights severely well, especially they're focusing a lot on Talkie Talkie, the Rumble of UP, because that was not the first time where he was ganked at top lane. And basically having that numbers advantage, UST then capitalizing on those things. So in a way, we see UST probably adapted to how UP played against them.
Yeah,
learning along the way.
Yeah, like I said before the start of this game, I think the top lane would be the main focus of who can win this fight, who can carry harder. And right now, Malphite showing that Malphite can carry this game. His ultimates just hit their targets very well. And I think UST is just showing us that they have the better team fight against UP.
So what do you think they should do at this point? Because I feel like, at least in terms of what's happening right now, do you feel like it's too late for UP to get back into the game? Because the poking potentials of Corki and Varus have met basically at this point.
But yeah, I don't think that UP is out of this game yet, because they're very even, though there's a 3k gold lead currently for UP. But as I was saying earlier, the poke coming from UST, it's at its peak right now. And actually, Corki, interesting enough, is getting a needlessly large rod.
Whoa! So imagine his damage is going to come from two avenues, attack damage and AP. This is insane, coming in from the AD carry of UST.
Yeah, and I think he might build a Ludens Echo for this.
Yeah, going to be painful.
Yeah, just to get the extra damage. I think the last time I saw this build was when Corki was used in mid lane, back when Hai was still the mid lane for Cloud9 in the previous season of NALCS.
Oh, wow.
And I think I'm not sure if they won that game, but it looked pretty impressive.
Well, because I have a special thing for Malphite being my only top laner, I feel like he's been playing these fights really well. Even until now, even though he is at a CS disadvantage against the Rumble, his laning counterpart, the CS difference has decreased between the two of them. So that's one thing to consider. And if you also look at his KDA, 836 versus 654 is really impressive. And I feel like Malphite, he's been playing Malphite really well in the sense where his kit is also used for utility in terms of knocking people up in a good way, guys. Not in a bad way, but being able to knock up members of UP, trying to set it up and doing a lot of damage because of his Sunfire Escape and the slow from the Iceborne Gauntlet, because that combination is insane. It really is, and it's been paying off. So even though technically we've been going back and forth on how the two main damage outputs, for example, are the Varus and the Corki, having that Sunfire Escape, for example, and even the Rek'Sai having built Warrior instead of the Cinder Hulk, they do a lot of damage, even just standing around, with the exception of the Cinder Hulk, obviously. Yeah. But that damage from the Malphite, just even being sandwiched in between enemy members of UP, a lot of damage goes over time. Yeah. So, good for them. That was a really good build, which is obviously one of the core items anyway.
Yeah, and earlier Malphite. I was also wondering, where would the AP damage come from? From the USC lineup. And they're building it up with the Nidisi, Lardrawn, and Cork. And I guess that Negatron Cloak might turn to Abyssal Scepter from the Malphite.
Oh my gosh. That's normally what I do actually when I play as Malphite. I build him as a tank first, and then I build the magic later on. The magic at the end of the rainbow, basically. That's my logic, and it usually works out pretty well. And now we see, at least as of now, the victor is at 5-5-5 against the 3-4-4 of the Varus. I feel like both of them obviously do a lot of damage, but in terms of positioning, the victor has been unfortunate in the last team fights where he's usually caught off alone and being reached through first by, for example, the Nautilus of the enemy team.
But to be fair, James Meister has also been having a lot of trouble in positioning in these fights. Like
both the mid laners, basically, are having a hard time right now.
Though the difference between them is that Victor right now is having a lot of trouble during team fights, but
In laning, he just did in mid lane.
Yeah, Varus would just walk up and Victor would say, "Hi, Varus," and just throw that laser and ult and Q combo at him, and he would just literally die on the spot.
I actually want to give a lot of props to the supports from both teams. I can actually remember the times where both the Pulverize and the Dredge line just being amazing from both teams, because I remember there was a clash at mid where the Nautilus actually flashed to dredge line an enemy, and when the Alistar basically pulverized Corki mid.
Right now.
Just kidding, guys, because the game has just unpaused, and now Victor was actually deleted from the team. Oh, but both the mid laners actually die from USD and UOP respectively, and we're gonna see if they're actually going to get Baron.
No,
I don't think so.
Yeah, both teams respecting each other, not trying to overextend just right after that pause. Both mid laners, I didn't exactly see how both of them went down, but but you could see right here that both teams are trying to recuperate and regroup, thinking of what their next move can be.
Oh, because the Sivir is still disconnected, as you can see right now.
Oh, the Sivir is still disconnected.
Because there is an 8-minute maximum pause time for each game of the best of three for the Rappler Gaming League Online Invitational. So now, at least as of this time, UP will want to play extra safely, because as of now, it's a 4-5 until their Sivir is able to reconnect. So the best thing they should do right now is be to ward, especially Baron Pit.
Yes.
Because USK might be able to take that advantage and take Baron, knowing fully well that they are one member up against UP. So we're going to see how both the teams are going to react to this situation, because it's all about adaptation.
Yeah, and sadly, UP losing their AD carry. This is one of their main damage dealers. We'll wait and see how they can adjust to this, and right now Victor's being jumped on at mid lane.
Oh, he's forced to use his Zhonya's, but it won't save him forever, because that was basically an incredible wombo combo. And now, instead of being 4-5, it is 3-5 right now, and I think USD has their eyes set on Baron.
Yeah, and the USD should just poke around this Baron right now. And
actually catching the Elise off, who was trying to contest it as much as she can, but no, she was basically eliminated and sniped by the virus, and the Alistar is trying to do his best, but I don't think he can do any more contention, and now UST, being undisturbed at this point, is trying to take Varus.
Talkie talkie right here, trying to be very sneaky in this bush, and he's not actually moving. He got caught by this Nautilus, and he might fall down right here against this UST lineup.
Oh my god, and now the Alistar, oh, the Dredgeline does land, and even he is trying to escape as much as he can, using the shield on himself, but the Varus might be able to poke him out, and he does, and now the Varus is at a killing spree, and Baron is at their disposal.
Yeah, UST getting that Baron is a very good buff. The Baron buff will prove very useful, because they are a poke team comp, and with that, I think UST will have the very big advantage. They just need to push out the mid lane. I don't think there will be a very good wave clear coming from UP with their Sivir still disconnected.
Exactly. That's another thing against them. Oh, and a teleport coming in from the map, right, using his ultimate. And with the Iceborne Gauntlet slowing him severely, it will not save him, even though he was forced to blow his flash.
Yeah, and Malphite right there showing that he has enough AP to kill this Victor.
With the Abyssal Scepter completed and Amplifying Tome nonetheless.
And right now, also, the Cork, interesting enough, completed his Ludens Echo and also has another needlessly large run.
Oh my gosh, that Corki, that, oh my gosh, this is gonna be so insane. And now UP is trying to do as best as they can with one member down, technically two, with the death timer still on the Victor. And now the mid turret of UP was basically chunked down by UST, and they are not giving any handouts.
And the Sivir just reconnected,
but
right
they
now
have enough
can
time.
Finish this game. They just need to push down these Nexus turrets. UP should try to...
The ultimate does blow! The Pulverize also does land, and they're trying to do it as best as they can. The ultimate of the Nautilus was negated by the spell shield of the Sivir. Tokitoki was actually able to take the Nautilus with the Equalizer landing properly. Corki missing his Phosphorus Bond, and now they're trying to retreat as best as they can. Clutch time indeed. The Sivir just reconnected.
Yeah, it's a very clutch reconnect from the Sivir, but right now UST just opened up the base of UP by destroying that inhibitor and one Nexus turret with it.
These
games right now is very interesting to watch. Guys, if you have any other people, you should tell them right now, this is a very crazy game happening between UST and UP with disconnections happening and all these
everything
comebacks.
You can imagine happening is probably happening right now. And we see Dragon is gonna be up in less than a minute, and at this point UP might not be in any position to contest this. Right now, I feel like they should focus on basically recuperating what's happening, waiting for their inhibitor especially to respond, considering that they only also have one Nexus turret at their disposal.
Yeah, and also UST has a 9,000 gold lead over them, and they just have this large damage output right now. I can't believe I'm saying this, but earlier I was harping about how UST doesn't have damage, but now they're building these AP items on this Corki and this Malphite, which is now giving them enough damage to delete this Victor and this Sivir.
Exactly. And now UST is trying to take their third dragon of the game, and the Victor tried to steal it. It does not work. Oh, and the Dredgeline does land on the Alistar. A little bit too tanky for the members of UST to commit to that. And now the Rumble is actually trying to push at the second tier top turret of UST. Will he be able to take it? I think he will. And now, although the other members of UST are trying to group up at bot lane, trying to make the trade equal and take the second tier bottom turret of UP.
Yeah, and UST right now not only sending Rek'Sai up on the top lane, and they're currently rotating to this bot lane. They don't have the Baron buff right now, but they have enough damage to take down this turret very easily.
And now we're gonna... Oh, and once again, the Dredgeline does that, and the Phosphorus Bond. The Alistar is almost at half health, and the Rumble is staying very strong at top lane. I can't believe he hasn't gone back yet. He does have a teleport though. The Rek'Sai does have her ultimate, so in a way both these have their teleports, and the Elise is able to go up in time, but will she last for long? The Corki was actually able to delete both the Elise and the Victor, and the Sivir was also, it's a triple kill coming in from the Corki. and we see that the Rumble might actually also die. It's a quadra kill coming in for the Corki. It's an ace, and I think UST will be able to take this game.
I actually thought Barros died there would be the best teammate ever and give the Penta over to the Corki.
They were completely at different sides. That was unfortunate. And now,
UP calling the GG, and they have surrendered this game with their Nexus exploding. It was very unfortunate for UP for their Sivir to have disconnected at such a crucial point in the game.
That was a really unfortunate time, and that was a pretty long game, guys. That was 41 minutes long. That was just so unfortunate because obviously, I mean, UST had a little bit of an advantage, but it wasn't as severe as the advantage UP had over them in the first game. And as soon as the Sivir disconnected, that was really unfortunate. And I feel like UP could have held off a little bit more if they didn't try to contest Baron. I actually feel like that was might have been a wrong move on their part. They probably should have given Baron, not contested, and tried to protect at the comfort of their base.
Yeah, I think UP right there, when their Sivir disconnected and couldn't come back immediately, they kind of maybe had a shot call problem, or maybe a morale, having problems with morale, because they just walked around aimlessly around the map, getting picked off one by one by UST.
At Baron.
Yeah, at Baron. And UST actually, I find it very surprising and very, I commend the UST lineup for tinkering around the builds of their champions. Though we could see the if they went the typical builds for their champions, they would have these disadvantages. But they made up for it by tinkering with these builds very uniquely in their own way.
But as you can see, because I know you had a really big issue about the lack of damage coming in from the UC lineup, but as you can see from the items that were built by both the Corki and the Varus, there is no defense item at their disposal. None at all. So you can imagine the amount of trust they had on their frontline, basically, and they were able to deliver.
Yeah, and there were various points in the game when they couldn't have that much damage, but they got that damage by tinkering with their builds. Like I said before, like Rek'Sai getting that earlier warrior enchantment.
Yep.
They got a bit of AD. Then UP built a lot of armor for it. But then Corki said, wait,
I'm gonna get a needlessly large rod.
Yeah, and build it into Luden. Then I'm Malphite, I'm getting an Abyssal Scepter. So I'm gonna reduce all your magic resistance. It's very little at that moment, and they won those fights out of that.
That was insane, and something is going to happen for the first time in this Rappler Gaming League's Online Invitational. Guys, we're going to have a Game 3, and it's coming up after this break. So, wait, after 15 minutes, we're going to see you for Game 3, and who will make it to the semifinals of the Rappler Gaming League's Online Invitational?